So, we have been discussing what in the last class we started talking about follow the online convex optimization problem, and in that we talked about the follow the ladder algorithm. So, in the last class, you notice that when my convex functions are of the form like my convex functions, in particular if I take it to be a quadratic loss function, we saw that my FTL algorithms give me what bound we got. So, my regret of my FTL was 2L whole square times, we got it to be log n, I think some constant, we got it of this order. Okay. So, we just wrote it as log n, but I think we will also end up with this one term here. Okay. So, what did we assume? We assumed this is a t, we assume this to be upper bounded by L, or we assume this to be upper bounded by L. We assume the L is this squared. Okay. If this is the case, then we will not get a square term here. Okay, so let us see, we said this log n term came from what? Summation 1 by t, t equals to 1 to n, right? So, this we said as log n, but I think the right upper bound is this, so that is why we will write it as log n plus 1, here it is just this part. Fine. So, good, if you have this quadratic function, so what was this? This we have defined it as this, and based on this, what was the algorithm gave us? Every time it gave us W of t is simply 1 z of I 1 to t minus 1. So, it basically said take the average of all the previous losses that you have observed. Why then? Let us take this kind of loss function. So, that is my linear loss functions, right? And we say that this linear loss function is nothing but we can interpret as this is the expected loss, right? Once the learner randomizes his strategy. Okay. How about applying this algorithm, FTL algorithm, on this setup? So, we will now argue that if you are going to use this setup, if you blindly apply your FTL algorithm on this, you may end up with a very bad performance. Okay, let us see why is that. So, for example, take your S, the convex set to be minus 1 and 1. And I am only going to interested in the scalar values now. I do not take them to be linear. I will just take, I am interested in a scalar case. So, the dimension is all 1 here. Now, in this case, I am going to treat like if their dimensions are 1, I could simply write them to be WZT. Both W and Z are scalar. So, it is like this. Okay. Instead of some D dimension, I am setting D to be 1. Now, suppose these ZTs that are chosen by the environment are such that, so ZT is chosen by the environment, right? It is up to him in whatever way he wants, he can choose them. So, let us consider one specific case. Let us say he chooses this to be 0.5 for the first round, and for the subsequent rounds, he is going to choose it as 1. If t is even, and is going to choose it as minus 1 if t is odd, odd and greater than 1. Okay. So, now let us see what happens if I am going to apply my FTL algorithm on this. Okay. So, let us keep on computing. What is my W1 is going to be, so what is my FTL algorithm will do? FTL algorithm will do arc mean over W over F of W T minus 1. This is what my FTL algorithm will do, right, in round T. So for W1, this is empty. So you play something. I don't care anything. I am not worried about it. Now let's take W2. What is going to be W2? So W2 is going to be minimum of F1 of W, but F1 of W is nothing but F1 function is going to be minus 0.5 of W, right, because Z1 is defined to be minus 0.5 in this. Okay, now keep on doing this. What is going to be W3? So W3 is going to be 0.5 W plus, yes, yeah. So W2 means I am looking at F1, right? So what is F1 of W? F1 of W is W in Z1. Z1 is that quantity. And what is this quantity is going to be? It is simply going to be W, right? Yeah, so this quantity is like F1 function. This is F1 and this is F2. And F2, we have this one here. And now if you are going to, like, if you continue to do this, let's do this one more time. What I'm going to get? 0.5 plus W. What I'll get? It's going to be minus W. So if you can continue to do this, you see any pattern in this? Right? So this guy here is going to be what? Minus 0.5 W plus 0.5 W, and whereas this guy is minus 0.5 W. So because of that, what will be the arc mean of plus 0.5 W, where W is coming from? So this W is coming from S, and we have taken S to be minus 1, right? So what is this quantity? It is going to be minus 1, right? And what is this going to be? Okay, if you do like this, what is that you are going to get for W5? You are going to get minus 1 like this. And like that it keeps on. So you see that what is happening? Your WIs are alternating from one round to another. Okay, so now let's compute what is the loss incurred by, we are interested in this quantity, right? Ft of Wt minus F of U. Okay. And now what is my Ft of Wt over n rounds? Okay, what is the first one is going to be? In the first round, it is going to be what? It is going to be plus 1. Okay. Okay, so let's ignore the first term F1, something I will get it as F1 of W1. So what is going to be F2 of W2? F2 of W2 is Wt into Zt, right? What is that going to be? When it is Zt, when t is even, I have 1, but whereas when t is even here, what I am going to get? 1. So Wt into Zt is going to be 1 when t is even. When it is odd, minus 1 into minus 1, we get again 1. So all the other terms here is going to be 1, 1, 1, 1, right? So this is going to be, let's say, n minus 1. And for time being, assume that my, this is also like my first loss is also 1, whatever you incur. I mean, I can do anything, but simply putting to be 1 here. Now, what is this quantity? So, this quantity is nothing but Zt into u, where t equals to 1 to n. So, the total loss incurred is almost 1, almost n, like I incurred loss in every round. And what is this quantity is? This quantity is nothing but u times t equals to 1 to n of Zt, right? And what is this is going to look like? Plus minus minus whatever it is going to look like, but I am interested in the smallest value of this, right? Because I will also be interested, this is for a given V, but if I am going to look over the minimum value of this, I can take this U to be between 0 minus 1 to 1. But how can I make this the smallest value? Like suppose, let us say n is an odd number, what will be this sum? Okay, whatever it is, let us say for time being, let us take an n in which this quantity happens to be, like after cancelling everything, only one term remains, that happens to be a positive number. Now, to minimize this, all I need to do is set this u to be 0. So, can I make this quantity to be 0 by choosing u to be 0 irrespective of what is this quantity is? Had it been a negative quantity, I would have chosen something, but let us assume this turned out to be, my n is such that this is a positive term. Now, because of this, if you look this over, if you now minimize over u, this quantity is nothing but n. Is this clear? So, what I am saying is the losses incurred by you total n, but the smallest you could have incurred is 0 by choosing your u to be 0. So, maybe like instead of this, let me just make it like min over u. Okay. Just let us look into this. Let us write down what happens. Let us say t odd number. What is the sum of Zt? Say odd number and greater than 1. So, let us take 3, 5, 7 like that. If it is 3, what is this number? And if it is 5, it is always minus 0.5. And if it is, if this, and if the t is even, it is going to be plus 0.5. So, this whole quantity here, depending on my n is odd or even, it is going to be minus 0.5 or plus 0.5. So, when it is plus 0.5, how can I make this the smallest value? By choosing u to be 0. Yeah? When u is, what is that we said? When it is, let us say, in this case, it is, okay, in this case, when it is 0.05, yeah, right, I can make it, we can make it just minus 1, in that case, it will be minus 0.05. Okay, let us do that, minus 0.05, and that minus with this minus, it becomes some 0.5. And if it is the other case, when I have minus of this, I am going to choose my u to be plus 1, it is still going to be, it is going to be still this, right? But still, if you see that this is still like order n, right? This is still order n. So, because of this, if you are going to use this follow the leader on a linear function here, you will end up with a very bad regret, Okay, you are. So, what's the issue here? It works so well for this quadratic loss functions or the quadratic functions, but it is doing so badly for the linear functions. So, and what is that like? Can we say something about this? So, what happened basically when we are trying to do this minimization, right? This is argmin. If I write simplify this, this is going to be simply w times z t, t equals to 1 to n with this function. So, depending on summation, the values, the argmin here, it was changing in every round, right? It was becoming plus minus as we argued here. It is changing in every round. Whereas, in the quadratic case, the change was not so abrupt. Why was that? No, I am asking about this loss function. So, in this loss function, what was my Wt? We wrote it right some, okay, we already written here. So, in this case, the Wt we found by this method, where my Fiw was this function, my Wt turned out to be the average. So, because it is an average, every term here will be influenced by what happened in the last samples. So, in a way, the change will not be that abrupt here, right? Because the past everything is kind of getting accumulation, because of that in the next round the things will not change that drastically. It is kind of a running average, right? Running average usually don't change suddenly. But whereas this, in this function, the things were changing very rapidly, right? Plus minus like that. So, in a way, the kind of past what has happened, it was kind of getting nullified. It has no impact on the current ones. So, such abrupt changes were making this algorithm kind of unstable. It is rapidly changing. Whereas, there is kind of stability here because your average, your updates are kind of getting averaged based on the past observations. So, in a sense, in a way, what this is telling is, for your FTL algorithm to give good performance, your weights should not be getting changed abruptly. And that was happening in my quadratic loss function, but it is not happening with my linear function here. So, now the question is it possible to make that even if I am going to observe a sequence like this, my WTs will not change so abruptly, so that the updates are in some sense are stable. Maybe if we can do bring in such kind of stability in this, even for my linear function, my FTL algorithm may do better. Okay, and usually the way to do bring that kind of stability is through bringing a regularizing functions. Okay, how many of you heard about regularizing functions? So, what kind of regularizers they use there? Okay, lasso for what? Yeah, but what kind of, what was the difference between loss and lasso and the L2 regularizer? So, one of them was trying to make your weights kind of sparse. But doing that, did you see any advantage? Right, I am asking whether they, fine, if the weights are very close, very small or 0, those features have no impact, you can, you better not use them. But the question is, did this improve performance? Okay. So, Okay, I mean in the test case you said there, but then did you realize what was the reason? Mm-hmm. Okay, so you are saying it kind of avoided overfitting. Anybody else came across this? But anything related to stability there?
Hmm. We want to make our models in some sense smaller. Hmm. Smaller model would be actually better.
So how is that? Okay, Lasso is ensuring by making sure that all the weights are not big enough, or not all the features are relevant. So some of them need not be given importance. But why is that the squared norm? Why smaller value? Why you are saying it's smaller value? You are adding it and then. They are adding it to the loss and trying to minimize it. Weights are large.
So if you are adding W square, so W can only be large
if it is really important.
Really important and relevant.
Okay. And the other way of looking at it is, okay, you are adding this L2 norm to the loss itself. This is other way of saying that you are trying to make sure that loss, that norm of L2 is not large, right? You can think of it like a constraint on norm of 2. You are constraining it to be within some value. Fine. It also kind of, so there you are kind of restricting your weights. There the goal was to make sure that you don't overfit to a training data. But here in this online version, our goal is to make sure that the updates are not becoming too erratic, in the sense the updates are not changing too much from one row to another. So we want them to be kind of stable. Like we don't, if it is abruptly changing too much in a way, that means that we have started kind of ignoring the past. So if we stay stable means we are completely not ignoring the past, like we are taking it and slowly allowing it to vary. Okay, fine. So then what is my regularized version of my follow the leader algorithm? Okay, we are going to study something called follow the So what we will do in this case is, instead of simply finding the sum of the minimum value of the sum of the losses we have observed so far, we will try to do this minimization after adding another regularizing term to this. So what this algorithm, we are going to denote it as FOREL. So RE here stands for regularized leader. So this algorithm is going to do for all t, wt equals to argmin over and this term we are going to call it as regularizer. So we are going to see different regularizers as we go on in the class, and we see that how they are going to affect our performance. So let's take a specific example of L2 regularizer, where I am going to define this RW to be this quantity. So I am adding this quantity directly to the loss, right? So I want this to be kind of small. And this is the normed version of this. So if I am doing this, I don't allow the minimizer to be kind of too big, right? Because of that, I will in some way I'm controlling its variations. Okay. Now with this, suppose if I take this and let's take my f of w to be simply my linear function, where f t of w is defined by w of z t. Z t is the parameter in round t. So if I plug in this, can you tell me what is the w t I'm going to get? So just plug in. You have put it here and put r norm of w here, and then differentiate and find out what is the w t you are going to get. Can you differentiate and tell me? Okay, but yeah, I'm going to also define this to be some parameter here. So this is good. Yeah, now tell me what happens. So if I'm going to differentiate this with respect to w, so this is going to be so do we get this? The minimizer w t star to be minus eta times summation of z t. Okay, sorry, I should be. So can I write it as so this is a summation from I equals to 1 to t minus 1, right? I can split this, make the summation I running from 1 to t minus 2 and separate out minus eta z t 1, but the first part is nothing but w star of till t minus 1, right? Okay. So what I have basically done is I have iteratively written these updates. If my previous update I have gotten in round t minus 1 was w t minus 1 star, and I got this z t minus 1, my new value is expressed as like this. Okay, now if you look into this function, my linear function, what is z t of here? So this is my f t of w, my variable is w. Then how can I interpret this z t to be here? Can I take this to be the slope of this function z t? Okay, so what I am doing here in this update, to get my w t star from this w t minus 1 star, what I am doing is basically subtracting the gradient or slope of this function, and with this coefficient of, but scaled by this coefficient eta, where is the eta is a term which is coming in my regularization function. So what I am doing to get the new update, I am subtracting this gradient of my function at t minus 1 from my previous update. So you see that my weights are not drastically will not change here, right? Because they depend on the previous update, and they are going to change as per the change in the gradient of my function. So because of this, so what I am doing, my weights are going to change. In fact, they are going to decrease based on, they are going to change based on this slope gradients. So because of this nature, if I am going to use this regularization like this, and I am going to use a slope like this, what I will get? My update rule to be a rule which we call it as gradient descent, right? Because this is my gradient and I am reducing my weights by that. So, we are updating as per this gradient descent method. So, alternatively, just to this what we are basically doing, we are saying that this is nothing but Wt minus star minus gradient of my FTW, sorry, minus eta, and that is computed at Wt. So, Zt minus 1 is the gradient of this function, right. So, this is this should be t minus 1. I am just going to write it as t minus 1. This is the gradient of my ft minus 1. Okay, so, because of this, we are going to call it as So, any question about this? So, we have ended up with a simple update rule, right, which is going to decrease the weights according to the gradients.